These kids are barely old enough to tie their shoes, but they've already mastered an amazingly complex job turning lines and squiggles on a page into stories.
My pencil jumped from my hand.
Dr. Andrew Papanicolau is trying to find out how they do it by looking inside their brains. He pioneered the use of magnetoencephalography, or MEG, for studying how they read. But he was an accidental pioneer.
We never looked for dyslexia. It looked for us.
MEG measures the magnetic field that brain cells create when they communicate with each other. The giant white hat here contains liquid helium, very cold stuff, which helps the sensors detect these tiny fields.
We were using magnetoencephalography to find out what side of the brain is involved in speech.
While testing one man with epilepsy, Dr. Papanicolau noticed something very peculiar. When the patient was listening to someone talking, his brain showed primary activation on the left side, like most people. But when he was reading, the activation appeared largely on the right side.
So we thought maybe we had the wires crossed, you know. So we did the test again and again, and then once in a while it's good to look at the patient and not only the machines. The person seemed to have difficulty, was squinting, you know, and someone asked him, can't you see the words? Is that why you have difficulty in reading? Can't you see them? He said, no, I'm dyslexic.
Dr. Papanicolau was hooked. And since then, he's been trying to understand how our brains work when we read. His findings match those of researchers doing functional MRI studies, like Sally Sheowitz at Yale and Guinevere Eden at Georgetown. While the entire brain is involved when we read, Dr. Papanicolau found that a high level of right side activation is a kind of cerebral signature of dyslexia. And that's what he saw in Peter Oathout, an 8-year-old who first met Dr. Papanicolau at a much more trying time.
The teacher said that he just broke down and started crying during the test. And she said he was just so frustrated because he knew he could answer the questions and he didn't want to quit, but he couldn't read the questions.
Peter's parents went online and found Dr. Papanicolau's research study.
Come on in.
Just wondering, are you going to put that thing on my head?
Yes, we are. We're going to.
Peter's brain showed a pattern of activation like other people with dyslexia tested in the study. Peter was expending more energy on the right side of his brain than good readers typically do.
It's like trying to paint with your toes rather than with your hands. I mean, you are doing something using perfectly normal equipment, but not suitable for the purpose.
To use another metaphor, while good readers use the interstate highways of their brain, Peter was using country roads to get to the same place. But there's good news.
The brain is incredibly plastic. And we know that as you learn new information, the brain physically changes. The neurons themselves, the brain cells themselves, change structurally.
So how do we go about rewiring a child's brain?
Through certain kinds of reading instruction, very carefully controlled, very intensive, these patterns of brain activation can be changed while at the same time the children's ability to read increases.
Dr. Papanicolau's study involved intensive research-based reading instruction.
Children who are struggling readers and don't get intervention do not get better.
Dr. ELDO Bergman is director of the Texas Reading Institute. Now, both of his sons have dyslexia, and because of that, he's devoted his life to helping struggling readers like Peter.
Okay. Peter came in to us as a kindergarten student frustrated with reading, had a phonologically based reading disorder.
Peter was tutored every week at the Texas Reading Institute. He worked intensively on his reading skills, connecting sounds to letters and learning to blend sounds. He practiced the same skills every night with his dad, who was trained by Dr. Bergman and his team. And after a year, the results were really impressive.
Mr. Duke, the coach, would explode if they were late.
Peter came to us reading in the bottom 10%. And when he finished, his ability to pull the words off the page was better than average, and his comprehension had gone from bottom 10% to the 85th percentile.
Okay, good. And this one, I think you corrected it. What is that word?
Ignite.
Good teaching made Peter a better reader and changed his brain in the process.
When children receive the appropriate sort of intervention, then their brain profile of activity changes. It becomes like the normal.
And the change goes well beyond the lab.
I mean, to see your child go from being unhappy and without self-confidence to being a happy, excited to go to school kid, it feels like a miracle.
We're only beginning to understand how brain imaging might help.
One of the problems usually with new technologies is that they tend to be oversold. Many people may be ready to say, well, now we are going to use MEG, fMRI, to diagnose dyslexia. I think that's jumping the gun.
Dr. Papanicolaou says imaging can complement the kind of assessments done by teachers and school psychologists.
The more you examine an issue from different points of view, you get a more complete picture.